Hello. Let me start my presentation or my talk with a question. How many people in the audience consider themselves a gamer? Can you raise your hands? Well, some people. And how many people own a mobile phone? Can you raise your hands? And how many actually played Pokemon Go? Ah, that's a little bit less. Well, I've brought another three games that I think everybody knows and have played in the last years, or maybe recently. I think a lot of people know this game, and this game. So let's consider that these are games as well, and computer games are games, and these old games are games, and let's consider that everybody is basically a gamer. And I truly believe that everybody is a gamer, that there's a game for everyone, and I'm not the only one. Johan Huizinga wrote a book about it quite some time ago, about the Homo Ludens. And basically what he said was, we have heard that a couple of times before this day, that through play you learn, and especially children learn a lot while playing. And if you stop playing, you get bored, and if you get bored, you stop learning, basically. And the thing is that gaming is gigantic, it's huge. And I just want to illustrate that with a couple of numbers. You don't have to know all the meanings, but just imagine, you can see that 40% of gamers are actually female. A lot of people don't know that. In the global digital game market, it's a lot of billions of dollars going on. And most people play games on mobile. And you can see also in the growth that on a year-to-year basis, it's almost $10 billion that are growing in the game industry. So it's really big, and a lot of people, millions and millions of people, are playing video games. But still, there's also a lot of negativity about video games, especially from the old media and newspapers and on television show. Gaming comes into the news a lot of times in a negative way, especially this kind of game, Grand Theft Auto. It's a very violent game. It's 18+, so if you're like 12, you should not play it, but still, kids play it. But it's sold 70 million times. But also, there's more educational games like Minecraft. It has sold more than 100 million games. It's gigantic. I know every kid that I know plays it, and you can build your own stuff. It's a very positive game. It's good to see that these kinds of games sell more than the more violent games. And of course, this is the biggest game of all times. I think everybody knows this. It's Tetris. So games are huge. Everybody plays games. Let's assume that everybody's a gamer. Still, there's a lot of negativity in the media. Oh, there's some stereotypes here. Gamers are lazy and fat, and they don't come out. They stay in the room all day. It's dumb. There's a lot of violence in video games. It's antisocial. It's addictive. And we have to take this criticism very seriously, because in some ways, they are true. Some people are very tangible, or they can be addictive for some people, but it's a very small amount of people. And there is a lot of violence in video games. And if you play 10 hours a day a video game, it's not healthy. I would suggest you go outside and take a walk, or if it's sunny, go out and do sports. But there's also a lot of positive sides on video games. And that side is not so much been talked about in newspapers or television show. And my life goal almost is to also show the positive side of video games. These are the three things I want to address against the negative sides, because you can learn so much from video games. You can really learn a lot. We learned that from the speak from Lauren already. And gamers can be very social. And of course, there's a unique form of escapism that only games can bring us. I mean, as a form of entertainment, as a form of media, gaming is truly unique. Let's start with the learning, especially if you have young children. It's more like learning on the side. They take so much information to them, especially young children, but they don't even know it. For instance, with this game called Mario Kart, for us it's very clear, you drive circles, you play with your friends. But you can see this player's in the sixth place, you see the track lined out on the right, you see the time, and you see the lap time. And for us it's very natural, but for a 4 or 5 or 6 or 7 year old, he or she doesn't really know that he or she is processing all this information on the side. There's another game called Assassin's Creed. It's a totally different game. It's kind of like a secret conspiracy game where you're playing an assassin in this particular game in Rome, in the old days of Rome during the Renaissance. And while you're walking during Rome, you learn about all these buildings, for this particular, the Colosseum. You can click on the buildings, and the game tells you when it's made, who had made it, what was the purpose of the game. This is a game called Civilization 6. It's been around for 25 years. The new sequel, the sixth sequel of the sixth part of the game, has just came out a week ago. And what you do is you choose a leader and a civilization, and you guide this civilization through the ages. But you learn about religion, you learn about culture, you learn about, for this instance, about Cleopatra and the way people irrigate their lands and fought wars and so on. And even in a violent game like Battlefield 1, which is about First World War, you can learn about the first tanks that got deployed during the war. And I didn't know there were Zeppelins during the First World War. So that's learning on the side. Then let's talk about the social stuff. People don't consider gamers that social, but you can still play with your friends on the couch. I mean, this is very PR marketing photograph nonetheless, but it's fun to play games with each other. It's not that different than playing cards with each other and be competitive. And the competitive side of gaming has grown so tremendously over the last decades that we now have esports, and that's very competitive. People can actually make a lot of money, and millions of people like to watch other people play in stadiums like this. Like thousands of people watching other people play video games, and a lot of people think that is very strange, but we think this is normal. There's not so much difference between them. The other thing is, and that's tend to get people really frown upon, is that people that are maybe a little bit timid or maybe a little bit more to themselves, by playing video games online with a headset up, you can talk to each other all over the world. So the world has become a very small place. You can talk to each other, you can chat with each other, and people actually meet up through playing games, and people actually got married through gaming. This is a screenshot of World of Warcraft, and the American issue of Cosmopolitan did a big report of 7 couples that met each other in World of Warcraft. It's a big online game, fantasy game. You can play dwarf, you can play orc, whatever suits you. I'm not judging, but it's nice to. I think it's a great story of people that met each other through a game and actually got married. I mean, I think that's a great thing. And then it's kind of my favorite part, it's escapism. I mean, games as the one media can make you do things you cannot do in normal life. I mean, you can read a book about being an adventurer or watch a movie about an action hero, but you're not the hero. You're not the Formula One driver. You're not the soccer player. In games, you can be all these kinds of things. You can take all these roles and feel it and feel like you're there. You can be an adventurer here in Uncharted 4, looking for treasure, or you can be Link. It's a hero of The Legend of Zelda, which is a very long franchise, and you can explore a magical land, fight against evil, or you can be an angry bird if you like. People like to be an angry bird sometimes. Then there's another part of escapism, and also another discussion, which maybe we're not going into too deep today, but it's a talk about art. Everybody thinks this is art, and I mean, everybody agrees, right? But I think video games can be art as well. I mean, they are very beautiful made, sometimes by a team of 300 people working for 3 years, 4 years. But there are also smaller teams that make video games, and they use their own style. This, for instance, is a game called Okami, and it's cel-shaded. It's a special technique where you have extra thick lines. And it's based on Japanese folklore, when you are playing actually the Japanese Zen god in the form of a white wolf. And instead of a sword or a gun, you have a celestial brush that you paint while playing the game. Then we have Monument Valley. It's a game that's been out for tablets like iOS and Android. And you can see Escher influences over there. These are puzzle games. And you see that they don't really, they're not logic, but you can still manipulate them, and you have to guide as a small princess from one place to each other. I would like to have this on the wall. I mean, I think this is art. And for my third example, this is where it really comes all together. It's a game called Bound. And what they did for that is that they motion captured. So that's, you put in all kind of electrodes on a human being. Ballerina from Scapino Ballet in Rotterdam. And they put her inside a game where you literally have to dance And in the background, you see all kinds of cubism surroundings falling apart. But I think we have a small movie clip of that.
PEGI 7.
Game, very dreamy like, but you can tell instantly if you ever watched some ballerina or somebody doing classical ballet. This is really beautiful, I think. You actually dance through the game. Basically, it's a platform game like Super Mario. But take a look at the background, what's happening. Worlds collide, structures move. There's a big stone bird in the background. And she actually uses moves that are from classical ballet. I don't know the French terms, but I think it's beautiful. And if somebody still, after playing this game or watching this game, and still says to me that video games are not art, I strongly disagree. That is games being escapism as art. And there's a third part I would like to address, and that is that games can also be used for talking about moral dilemmas and experience unique emotions. A year ago, there was this game called This War of Mine, and it's basically kind of a simulation game, a kind of a Sims game. Maybe some people heard of it. But it's based in during the former Yugoslavia war. And you are with refugees in a house, and you have to survive. And that means you have to take moral choices. So either you go out and steal food with one family to support your own children, or maybe your children won't survive. So it's not a fun game. It's a very dark and heavy game. But the money they gained from this game, they put in a charity for children that suffered from war traumas. So This War of Mine is a totally different example of a video game and how it's been put to use that people normally don't think about. And the last example I've had is a very sad story, but a very touching story at the same time. It's called Dead Dragon Cancer. And it's a game about a boy. It's an autobiographical game that the parents, Amy and Ryan Green, made for their boy, Joel. And when Joel came to life, he got diagnosed this very early with cancer. And his life expectancy was a couple of weeks, maybe 4 months. Well, in the end, he lived until his fourth. And then he died of cancer. But what did the parents do? They made a video game about it. I know, it's insane if you think about it. But it was their way of grieving, of mourning. And a lot of parents reached out to them, and they got a lot of press. And yeah, it was their way of mourning. So a video game is a way of mourning and grieving about a lost child. I mean, I think that's very special. But not to end on a sad note, I think what I talked about today is just the tip of the iceberg. There's so much more coming. I mean, virtual reality is really coming on this year. We have the HoloLens of Microsoft, so we're just starting to scratching the surface of all the possibilities. Nintendo is coming out with the Nintendo Switch next year. That's something I'm personally very excited about. But if I wanted to address something today, is that we've heard a lot of great talks already. We heard about personal loss, about recurring cancer. We got learning, playing. But if I could maybe change your opinion about video games a little bit, then I'm happy. And maybe you can talk to gamers a little bit more or try playing a video game yourself. And maybe you will end up like this. Thank you.